This is the Polestar 4, and in this video I'll be testing range and consumption, cabin noise and also the charging. Welcome to It's Only Electric. Let us start with the basics.
It's Only Electric.
It is a SUV coupe measuring 4.8 meters in length with a wheelbase of 2.8 meters. It weighs 2.35 tons. This specific car is the Polestar 4 long range all-wheel drive and is also equipped with the Plus and Pilot package. It's built on the SEA platform, exactly the same as the Zeekr 001. It's all-wheel drive with two permanent magnet synchronous motors, one at the front and one at the back, both delivering 200 kilowatts with a combined output power of 400 kilowatts or 544 horsepower. It also has 686 newton meters of torque. It should be able to do 0 to 100 in 3.8 seconds with a top speed of 200 kilometers per hour. It is a 400 volt system and it should be able to charge from 10 to 80% in 30 minutes with a top speed of 200 kilowatts. When it comes to AC charging, it charges 11 kilowatts or 22 kilowatts if you go for the Plus package. We will see about the charging speed later in this video. It has a large battery with a gross capacity of 100 kilowatt hours and a net capacity of 95. Its stated WLTP are 570 kilometers. It drives on 21 inch wheels with Michelin Pilot Sport tires and they measure 255-45 all around. Let's start driving. Time for the range and consumption test. We drive it the same road, same stretch every time. It's a fixed route of 80 kilometers and it's varied speeds all the way up to 110 kilometers per hour. And the average speed should be 93 kilometers per hour for the whole stretch. We have a couple of set rules and the first one is we always stick to the speed limit. The second one is we put the car in eco mode and in this case it's range mode. I've done that. And the third one is we put the AC on 20 degrees and the eco if available, and I've done that also. So everything is in order. I have just passed 25 kilometers and the average consumption right now is 21.6 kilowatt hours per 100 kilometers. And this feels fairly decent for this car. It's a big, heavy car and it's not meant to be an efficiency monster. It's four-wheel drive with 544 horsepower, but I think 21.5 is expected. And we're driving on 21-inch wheels, that's 255-45 all around. So not the most efficient setup either. And it's also raining a little bit, so the road's a little bit wet slash damp. So this will also affect the consumption. I will also add some thoughts and personal opinions about this car in this video. And to start with, I never liked the Polestar 2. I think it was a compromise of a vehicle. I think it was too cramped, too dark. I don't know who would choose that before a Tesla Model 3, for instance. It's bigger, it's more fun to drive, more comfortable. But this Polestar 4 is actually a really good car. I really like it. It's big, it's luxurious, it has a performance. And overall, it surprised me. They call this car a SUV coupe. I would call it a shooting brake, but it's actually pretty tall. It's a big car. So I think the ground clearance is 166 millimeters or something. So almost like a Tesla Model Y, but it doesn't feel like that. It doesn't drive like that. For me, it's drive like a shooting brake or a sedan. I sit pretty low. The seats are really low. And it feels like a GT, like a Grand Tourer. This car is perfect for longer trips. It's quiet, it has good performance, it's fun to drive. Overall, it feels like a great package. And I like the coloring inside with this black and gray. And I like the steering wheel, I like the screens, and the Harman Kardon sound system. In first, I was a little bit disappointed because the Yamaha system in the Zeekr 001 is really, really good. Is one of the best ones on the market, I think at least. And I expected a similar sound system from this Harman Kardon one in the Polestar 4, but it isn't the same. It's still a good system. I think the bass sometimes disappears. The subwoofer feels a little bit too small. I can hear it a little bit in the background, but I don't feel the punch. The seats are really good. I like this faux leather. It feels great. The thigh support is really nice. So overall, I think this is an amazing package, and I'm surprised by Polestar. I have just passed 40 kilometers, and the average consumption right now is 19.5 kilowatt hours per 100 kilometers. It has a really big battery, 100 kilowatt hours of gross capacity with a net capacity of 95. So it will be interesting to see the total range of this vehicle. The Polestar 4 is equipped with the speed limit warning system that's mandatory by European law for all cars produced 2024 and later, and sold in Europe, of course. It has a couple of ways to turn it off. I've put a shortcut button on the screen, but there's also one on the steering wheel, and you also have a menu for it. But let's speed up a couple of kilometers and see what's happening. Beeping right now. You cannot deactivate the speed limit warning system by the steering wheel if you have the cruise control on, but if it's off, you can just, it's beeping again, you can just press downwards two times in this case, and now it's off. And you will see a little menu on the screen with a speaker and a line on it, and it's, you're pressing down. So pretty easy. Otherwise, if you want to turn off the speed limit warning system, I have a shortcut on the favorite shortcut screen, and it's on the home screen, and here you have the same speed with a speaker, and it's orange right now, so if I press it, it gets white, and now it's turned off. If you don't have this shortcut, you can just press the car, it's the car settings, and here you press assist, and on the top right you have the speed limit warning. You just press that, and now it's off. And here you also have the driver alert, lane keep aid, and also blind spot information. You can also go into pilot assist, and here you can activate the lane changing assist, so on and off. On the topic of the speed limit warning system, we also have adaptive cruise control, lane keep assist, and active lane changing assist. So it has it all, and this is the pilot package, so it's an extra optional cost. But to activate the adaptive cruise control, you just press this instrument cluster, like the old-fashioned one. So just press that one, and it will set the speed you're currently driving. And then you can press up or down, and it will change your speed by 5 at a time. And then you have left and right, and here you will change the distance in 3 increments. So near, medium, and far from the cars in front. So really easy. And when you activate the adaptive cruise control, it automatically starts the lane keep assist and active steering. And this car is really stable. The car is not wobbling at all. Keeps the distance really good, and the steering is so stable. I think this is one of the most stable like lane keep assist I've ever driven, because it doesn't ping pong at all, and it's really smooth at all times. If this is not the best adaptive cruise control and lane keep assist, it's one of the best at least. So it's really stable, it doesn't complain. You just need to hold the steering wheel, it doesn't complain at you at all. Let's try to change the lanes. So I put the blinker on, holding the steering wheel, and it doesn't change. Okay, that was me. Let's try that again. What we see. It should indicate with an arrow to the right or left if it can change lanes. So let's try it again. Put the blinker on. Okay, now it's changing for me. That actually worked great. So it needs to be a small arrow on the head-up display and on the left side on the instrument cluster. So just a small arrow to the left or right, depending on which lane you're driving in. And the other buttons on the left side of the steering wheel is resume. So you resume your adaptive cruise control and lane keep assist. And the one on the bottom is AX, so you cancel the adaptive cruise control. On the right side, you have your voice assistant, and you have like 3 screens, and it explains itself. You change the view of your instrument clusters. So you can have the maps, you can have the lanes, and you can have a simple, just a black one with your speed and battery percentage and your range. And the third one under it's three lines with an arrow, and here you can adjust things. So you can adjust the mirrors, the steering wheel, you can get trip information and reset the trip information. You can change the range value to dynamic or standard, or you could go to speed unit and change to miles per hour. I don't know why it should be this easy to do it, but it is there if you wanted to. I have mixed feelings about this button. They are like touch, but you really need to press them. And if you miss a little bit, it doesn't press. You really need to press on the right spot. And I really would prefer real buttons, like physical buttons, and not these capacitive touch buttons. I don't know why they keep insisting on doing this. It's also equipped with a head-up display, and it's pretty big, it's bright, it's really clear, so it looks good. I think it's a little bit Spartan, it lacks a couple of features. I think it was like AR and everything that Volkswagen has right now, and that would look even better and give some extra functionality. It is time to summarize the range and consumption test. It was 10 degrees outside with light rain and wet roads, so not the optimal conditions, and we're driving on 21-inch 255-425 summer tires, so not the optimal either. But the final consumption landed on 19.7 kilowatt-hours per 100 kilometers, and that equates to 482 kilometers of real-world range, or 85% of the stated WLTP. And this is not great. I expected more, and even when driving it, I thought it would drop a little bit more at least, but it didn't. And this is exactly the same problem as the Zeekr 001 has. It's not that efficient. It should land on 90% of the stated WLTP, so like 530, 540 kilometers. But yeah, it's not the most efficient car. The battery is really large, that's why it has a decent range overall. But 85% in these conditions is a little bit lackluster. If you compare it to, say, a Model Y from 2022, a performance one, also 21-inch wheels, and even wider tires at the back, I think they're 275. That has a similar range, but a battery that's 20% smaller. And these are in the same conditions, like 10 degrees outside, damp roads. So for a more in-depth review of this car, don't forget to check out the full review. It's linked up here. There we'll go through the car in more details, so check that one out. But we also did a high-speed range test of this car, so 120 kilometers per hour GPS speed or 124 kilometers per hour indicated in the instrument cluster. And the average consumption landed on 25.9 kilowatt-hours per 100 kilometers. And that equates to a real-world range of 366 kilometers. I drove the car in range mode and put the AC on 20 degrees and eco, so same as always. To the next topic, and this is the cabin noise test. We always measure the cabin noise on the same road, same stretch. We put the microphone in head height on the passenger side, and we measure at 50, 70, 90, 110 kilometers per hour. And it's a decent cabin, it's pretty quiet. It's in the middle of our pack in our test, so a good cabin noise, and the sound is pretty decent. It's better than the Zeekr 001 with 22-inch wheels, and it's a lot better than the new Model Y Uniper with 19-inch wheels, so Tesla has a long way to go. But this Polestar is still worse than the premium German cars, like the BMW, Mercedes, or Audi A6 Q6, for instance. It doesn't have double glazing. I think that would help a lot, because you can hear some wind noise from the B-pillars on both sides, and also some road noise. But still, it's a good cabin noise. To the last topic, and this is charging. I couldn't find any manual preheating in the system, but you can preheat the battery by navigating to a charger. So I navigated to a charger with the built-in Google Maps, but there is some lack of information. I couldn't see if it's preheating or not. I couldn't hear the heat pump, but it was probably on. So I navigated approximately 45 minutes before I wanted to charge the car, and I plugged it in and charged from 10 to 80%, and it took 31 minutes and 2 seconds, which is almost on spec. It says 30 minutes flat, so 1 minute and 2 seconds extra is expected probably. And if you look at the charging curve, you can see the charging dips probably overheating a little bit. But the problem for me is 30 minutes, I don't think it's good enough anymore. I think the new normal is approximately 25 minutes because you have cheaper German cars that's charged at 24, 26 minutes. The ID series, the Cupras, the Audis are even better than that. And this is a premium car. 25 minutes, 24 minutes would be great. And the top speed I saw was 205 kilowatts and it's spec'd at 200, so on point. And the average charging speed was 134 kilowatts. And at 80%, it was still charging at 78 kilowatts. So yeah, as I said, I expect a little bit more in 2025 from cars. Let me summarize this car, my thoughts and my feelings of it. The long range rear wheel drive starts at 700,000 SEK or 64,000 euros. This one, long range all wheel drive with plus pilot package, another color, tinted windows, and the 21 inch wheels start at 842,000 kronor or 77,000 euros. And the plus package includes the Pixel headlights, the Harman Kardon sound system, and also 22 kilowatts of AC charging. Overall, I think this car is a really good package. Like, the premium feel is amazing. The fit and finish is good. Materials are premium. And it feels on par with its price. I like it. And exterior-wise, I think it looks really good from the front, low and wide. The back is a little bit harder. I would prefer a rear window, probably. And it's a little bit high and bulbous in the back. But it looks decent. Overall, it's one of my favorite cars, especially for the driving experience. It feels like a train on a railroad. It's really nice at higher speeds. It's decently quiet. The suspension is really nice. No miss sounds or nothing. The steering is perfect heavy at the heaviest settings. And it's a real like motorway cruiser. I really like how it drives. And the two motors suits this car really well. It feels like a grand tourer. Like 3.8 seconds, 550 horsepower. It feels really great. The adaptive cruise control, when you turn it on, it's a little bit laggy or slow to respond. So sometimes I press two or three times before it activates. Maybe I'm too stressed. It can be a little bit sluggish. Same with the menu sometimes. It gets a little bit slow. I turn something, things off, and it turns on again. And some small bugs here and there. And the same thing with the climate controls. I can put it in Eco when I did the range test. And then I turn the Eco off in the menu so I can see it's gray now. But here in the bottom, it still says Eco. And then I press like manual, try again, it still says Eco. And then I put full blast and then again, and then it's removed and says auto. So there's some small bugs in the software. I don't think it's a deal breaker, but I'm not living with this car, so I cannot say if this gets really annoying after a while. But there is some small bugs, and I think Polestar should work a little bit on the software. Like the charging screens gives you amps and volts and no kilowatts. It's okay for me, but I don't think that everyone would understand this. And the charging screen on the central display doesn't say anything. You can just adjust the maximum charging percentage, like to 90% or 80%, but nothing else. I cannot see the kilowatts, I cannot see temperature, nothing. It really doesn't give me all the information. I really want some information about the preheating. I want the kilowatts, expected time or something. You get some expected time in this screen, but still a little lackluster. But otherwise, it's a good system. I would say this car is perfect, but it lacks efficiency. The two permanent magnet motors, so it's always on and dragging. So the efficiency should be better because the range is not enough for being a real highway cruiser, not with a 100 kWh battery. And the second thing is the charging. If you want this to be a highway monster, you need better charging than 30 minutes. And if you have the money and you like this type of car, I think this is the perfect car. But I'm eagerly awaiting a facelift on this one with, as I said, better efficiency, better charging, and double glazed windows. Otherwise, I really like this car. What do you think? If you had the money, would you go for the Polestar 4 or a Zeekr 001? Maybe a BMW i5 or an Audi? Let's have a discussion, comment down below, and we'll answer as fast as we can. I hope you enjoyed the video. Thank you for watching. Don't forget to subscribe, share the video, and like it. And as we always say, stay electric.